Under Indian law, discrimination on the basis of caste is outlawed, but it's a law that is largely ignored.
We've come to the town of Anantapur in the southern state of Andhra Pradesh for a Dalit rally. There are Dalits from over 1,000 villages coming here. There are truckloads arriving, and they say they're fighting for dignity, power and rights.
The protesters said state government and local police forces don't implement the anti-discrimination laws. They want central government in Delhi to act.
I've been talking to activists here, and they've told me they've done research that shows 120 different forms of discrimination in the state of Andhra Pradesh, from cinemas, hospitals, schools, and they say that this is what they're determined to fight. Why did
you come here? Kamupalam Srinivas helped found the Andhra Pradesh Dalit organization. They now have 40,000 members.
He says, we're going to fight to the end. We want an annihilation of the caste system. The only way we can do this is if we get political power, and we're going to fight for political power.
He wants to forge a civil rights movement, just as black Americans did in the 1950s.
He says this can only be done via education, to raise awareness and then raise consciousness.
He told the protesters to defy the caste system, to marry who they want, to go where they want. In every town in India, Dalits do the jobs the higher castes won't because they consider them unclean.
About 6 o'clock in the morning, I'm a 3-hour car ride north of Delhi. I'm following a group of Dalit female workers over there, and they're going on their daily job run. They've got the worst job assigned to Dalits. Every morning they have to clean the toilets of upper caste people.
In the Hindu religion, you inherit your caste, and caste largely determines what jobs you can do. Sangeeta Hans comes from a family who, for generations, have cleaned upper caste toilets by hand. By hand. By hand.
So we're following Sangeeta, and she's literally is going from toilet to toilet, scooping up excrement, carrying it round a basket. The stench is really quite unbearable.
This is because of the caste system, nothing else.
Wilson Bezwada, the Dalit activist accompanying us, told us it's illegal to remove or carry excrement by hand. But the law is not enforced. Wilson still remembers how, at the age of 10, he found out that this is what his parents did.
Then I just started crying and I thrown them out. I said, stop this. This is very bad. You please stop.
In India, this job is called manual scavenging because it's done by hand. An estimated 1 million Dalits do it every day.
How does it make you feel, Sangeeta, having to do this?
Hame bahut dikkat hoti hai. Dimag mein chadhta hai gand.
She said, well, I've got no other choice. I can only do this job. She also said that the smell just really gets to her, goes up her nose, and it just makes her vomit. And she says, this job just makes me want to die.
Only Dalits do this job. Sangeeta told me she desperately wishes she didn't have to pass it on to her children. Another Dalit activist, Paul Devarkar, took us further into the countryside. He said that in most villages in India, Dalits and upper castes are segregated. The village of Kalila is typical.
So on a simple level, upper castes on this side of the road.
Right.
Dalits, lower castes on this side of the road.
On the side of the road.
And the road divides them.
Everything divides them.
And this is so the lower castes don't pollute the upper caste.
Yeah. But yet they're nearby to do the daily menial, manual work for the dominant caste.
I began to speak to the local Dalits. Paul said we'd have to be quick. They'd be too scared to talk to me if upper caste villagers arrived.
It's the Dalit part of the village. You see the services that are there. These are all restricted for us.
So services are not restricted for the upper caste members. I see we have an upper caste member watching us right here behind us.
If you're a Dalit, then you can't have land.
Why can they have land and you can't? Behind our camera, other upper caste villagers arrived.
Well, we've just been told that because the upper caste members are listening into our conversation, nobody will really talk to us and they're intimidated. The only way we can talk is in one of their homes. The upper caste villagers are following us, and you can sense that there's tension here in the village. We've just been told we can talk for a minute because they're gone. This woman just grabbed me now and she said, to hell with them. We're not allowed to go to their temple, so can I open it? So we've got our own temple.
There was a large village temple down the road, she said, but she's had to make her own.
I just asked her why she's not allowed in the temple and she said the only reason is because we're lower caste.
Why don't you do something about it? Why don't you protest? Many high caste villagers believe if a Dalit enters a temple, they will pollute it.
She says that the Dalits once tried to enter the temple and they were physically pushed out of the temple. And this is what it's come to. It's come to a makeshift temple in a cupboard. And they're too scared to even walk through the other part of the village.
Dalits who step out of line run great risks. Every year, over 24,000 Dalits are murdered, raped, or assaulted because of their caste. The perpetrators are rarely brought to justice. We travelled 500 miles west of Delhi to the state of Gujarat. Manjula Pradeep heads the largest Dalit rights group in the state. She spends her time fighting to get cases to court.
It's first thing in the morning and we've just heard that a manual scavenger, a Dalit who cleans toilets, has died. We've also heard that other Dalits have dragged his body outside the municipality who hired him in protest. We're on our way there now.
Hundreds of manual scavengers die doing this work every year.
That's the dead body.
Gopal Makwana had been cleaning a sewer blocked with excrement when he was overcome by fumes. He died later.
There's a sign over Gopal's body, and it says, this man was employed by Gujarat Sanitation Division, and it's because of the negligence of this municipality that this man is now dead.
For 2 days, Gopal's colleagues have stood vigil to call for compensation for his family. Manjula reminded us manual scavenging, cleaning excrement by hand, is illegal. But that's what she believes this man was employed to do.
This is treated as an accidental death. And we think that this is not an accidental death, this is a murder.
She wants the chief officer of the municipality prosecuted.
As the chief officer, can you explain to me why manual scavengers are employed by this municipality when this practice is illegal?
No. No manual scavenging is employed or exercised here.
Again and again, he insisted Dalits weren't employed as manual scavengers in his municipality.
What will you
manual
do?
Manual scavenging is not here at all.
I put his claim to the test.
Can we ask these protesters if they work as manual scavengers, just put up their hands, just to show us.
These are the people the chief officer says don't exist. The police have taken no action over Gopal's death. For Dalits, access to education has become a critical issue. The government reserves 16% of public sector jobs for Dalits, but most of those jobs are menial because they're uneducated. Because they're uneducated. Because they're uneducated.
Patna, the capital of Bihar. Right in the middle here, there's a rally of Dalit children. They're demanding equal rights of their upper caste classmates. They're now chanting, let us study in schools, don't let us work. Many of these little children are forced to work and clean toilets when they go to school. This banner here says, don't insult me. This banner up here says, don't call us lower caste. This one is saying, let us study.
Inside, Dalit teachers are gathering evidence of discrimination.
These teachers here are asking these Dalit children what happens to them when they go to school. This little girl was saying that Dalit children in her school are given different food to upper caste children. And a few girls in the back row were saying that when they go up to their teacher to ask for help, the teacher shoos them away and says, get away, you smell. It says, get away, you smell. It says, get away, you smell.
By the time they're 11, 70% of Dalit children have dropped out of school. Listen to Vikas and you start to understand why.
This tiny little boy has just told me that the teacher says to him, you're a musahar, you're a rat eater, don't mix with us, don't mix with the other children, you stick with your rat eaters.
Dalit children are often denied access to school toilets. Vikas told me that one day he asked if he could use one. The teacher locked him in the cubicle for 6 hours. For 6 hours. For 6 hours.
What did you think when your teacher did this to you? Vika says that when he was locked in the toilet, he said, I was very scared. It was very dark in there, and the teacher only opened the door in the afternoon.
Without education, Dalits can't share in the wealth of India's booming economy. Nearly 90% of Indians who work for multinationals are from the upper castes. Everywhere I'd been, I'd found the Dalits, the broken people, getting angrier. They're surrounded by the wealth of an emerging superpower. Institutionalized oppression on a vast scale stops them sharing that wealth. Institutionalized oppression on a vast scale stops them sharing that wealth. Institutionalized oppression on a vast scale stops them sharing that wealth. In India's poorest state, Bihar, we went to the village of Birkir Chapolia.
Namaste.
Poverty affects all castes, but 60% of those below the poverty line are Dalits. Some Dalits here are so poor, they eat rats.
Jalad told me that he needs to catch about 15 rats a day to feed his family. There are about 5 people in his family. He says he has to do this because he can't afford to buy food.
Even within the Dalits, there are caste divisions, and the musahars, the rat catchers, are the lowest of the low. Most of the children are malnourished. Almost no one can read.
As soon as the guys caught the rats, the little boys started cooking them and they started eating and they said, we need to eat now, we're hungry. And talking to the rat catchers, they felt really uncomfortable about eating rats and they kept saying, we're forced to eat these rats because we've got no money, we can't afford to buy food.
But even here you can see the glimmerings of the new civil rights movement. Girija Devi believed passionately that the caste system will be eradicated in her lifetime.
Girija has been organizing the villagers to stage sit-in protests outside government buildings, and she says that these have been successful and they've been getting government services and jobs, which she says that Dalits are entitled to. Where did you get the courage to stand up to the upper castes like this? Were you threatened? Girija says we don't feel threatened fighting the upper caste because we're fighting for our rights and we're all fighting this together. Does everybody here agree with that?
Yes. As
we're just leaving, Girija says that if things don't change for Dalits, she will feel bad. But she said that the struggle will continue, even if that means it turns into a physical struggle.
Sadly, Giriji will never see her wish fulfilled. She died of a heart attack 3 weeks later. But 170 million Dalits are beginning to make similar demands. And as India emerges onto the world stage, it's going to face growing international pressure to stamp out a system of oppression that even its own prime minister has described as a blot on humanity.
Next Friday at 7:35, Unreported World is in South Africa, looking at the real Cape Town. Coming up next here on 4, A Place in the Sun, Home or Away. Strong.